Well, this morning, I want to share a message with you that I think will be beneficial to all of us. And it's entitled, What About Those Shadows? Everybody goes through them. Everybody has challenges in different ways sometimes, but we all struggle with things in our lives. Amen? So if you would turn with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 1. 2 Corinthians chapter 1. And I want to encourage you after the service this morning, if you just take a few minutes and give one another a hug, visit a little bit, greet one another. I didn't get a chance to say hi to a lot of people this morning, and I'd like to do that as well. Take the time to do that. I remember going to a very, very large church one time, over 1,000 people. And after the service, I was really touched by the message and by the worship, and I just bowed my head and just was thanking the Lord, and I looked up, and I was alone in the building. And it was like, whoa, even the pastor left. Everybody left. And I thank God we're not that sure. We want to hang around and get to know each other. Amen? Don't let the devil lie to you and say, well, you're going through this. Everybody else seems to be doing fine. That's not true. Everybody goes through struggles. Everybody goes through pain. And so in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 8 and 9, we're going to talk about the Apostle Paul, who was, I believe, one of the most anointed people in the Bible. He was one who was blessed with a trip to heaven in the Spirit and saw things that God told him, you can't write about this. So he was taken up in the Spirit. The Bible says to the third heaven, and some people say there's many levels of heaven. No, there's one heaven. But the first heaven is referred to as the air we breathe. The second heaven is referred to as the stars and the planets that we see and those that we don't see. And the third heaven is where God lives. That's far beyond anything we can see or even imagine, the Bible tells us. So Paul was caught up there. You would think after all that, Paul would just have a blessed life, you know, just be happy all the time. Amen? Well, let me read to you what he said here to the Corinthians in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, and starting with verse 8. He said, "For we would not, brethren, have you to be ignorant or uninformed of our trouble that came to us in Asia, that we were pressed out of measure, above strength, insomuch that we even despaired of life." He says, "But we had the sentence of death in ourselves, that we should not trust in ourselves, but rather trust in God who raises the dead." Amen? Amen? So we've been studying on Wednesday night in the book of Acts, and we just got through studying about the Ephesians, and then Paul went to Greece, and everywhere he went, they tried to kill him. He had to escape out of a basket one time over a wall in the city before they got to him. And when they couldn't find him, they beat up his buddies. So he had a lot of trouble. And Paul is being very gracious to share the truth with the body of Christ and say, I don't want you to be ignorant about the trouble that I've had to go through. Now, Paul was a godly man, and he was completely focused on serving the Lord. Amen. That was his life. If you understand Jewish culture, in Jewish culture, if you receive Christ as your Savior, your family cuts you off. You are dead. Sometimes they even have a funeral for you. The Israelites did not believe that Jesus was the Messiah, the Jews. They didn't believe it. So Paul turned to go to the Gentiles. He was a Jew of Jews. If you understood, he was in the Sanhedrin. Now, there are Pharisees. Pharisees are people who were priests, and they taught the people. They were teachers. But then there was the Sanhedrin. They were the 70 top rulers in Israel. Paul was one of those. And in order to be in one of those, you had to memorize Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. Count me out on that one, okay? Especially Numbers. If you've read the book of Numbers, how would you memorize the book of Numbers? And they memorized those. And then also to be in the Sanhedrin, you had to have a wife and you had to have children, and they had to be totally in submission to the leader of the house. So Paul had all those things going for him when he gave his heart to Christ. He said, "Brethren, I have suffered the loss of all things." When Paul said all, he meant all. He lost all his buddies in the Sanhedrin, 69 of them. Then he lost all the Pharisees that were his friends, except for, I believe, Nicodemus and Joseph of Arimathea, who came to get Jesus' body after the crucifixion. He lost all his friends. And then he had the Jews, who were his friends, trying to kill him everywhere he went. And some said, "This man is turning our city upside down." Unfortunately, they didn't realize their city was upside down. Paul was trying to turn it right side up. So he loved God. And here he's writing to the church in Corinth about the suffering that he endured. But he assured us of this. All of these things have happened to him so that he would learn to rely upon God. And I say this to my brothers this morning as well, because you know how we like to fix stuff. Man, we glory when our kids or our grandkids come in the garage and say, "Hey, I broke this. Can you fix it?" It's like, even if you don't know how to fix it, you'll either fix it or break it and buy them a new one. Amen. But we will fix it. And we kind of want to do that. We want to fix stuff. And Paul learned, I can't fix it. And we have to learn, we can't fix it. Sometimes we look to politicians thinking they're going to fix it. No, The Bible says in Jeremiah 17:5, "Cursed is the man who puts his trust in the arm of flesh, but blessed is the man who puts his trust in the arms of the Lord." Amen. So there are many things that happen to us that seem to defy explanation. Things that happen to us that we go, "Where's this coming from? Man, I'm eating right, I'm living right, I'm praying right, I'm worshiping God. Why is all this happening?" The fact is, we're living in a fallen world that's filled with sin, and really bad things come along with that. And that's exactly what the Word of God teaches us. All have fallen short of the glory of God. There's none who understands, Romans chapter 3 tells us. None who does any good. In fact, Ecclesiastes chapter 7 and verse 20 says, "There is not one just man upon this earth that does good and does not sin." By the way, you know, when Pastor Joe was up here sharing about God marking the book, that is absolutely true. Malachi chapter 3 verse 16 through 18 says, "Those who feared the Lord and thought often upon his name, God wrote a little book of those things which they spoke who feared the Lord." And the Bible says, in the day when I make up, God speaking, in the day when I make up my jewels or my special treasure, they shall be mine, says the Lord, because they have served me and I love them as a father loves a son. And so God does pay attention to what we do. He does watch us. So I would like to share this morning, in the midst of whatever challenges you and I are facing, and we all are, we all have some challenge. It's either a family member that we've been praying for and they're just not hearing it. And I had a pastor friend really help me out with this one time. I was frustrated, man. I've been talking to this guy for over 30 years about quitting drinking alcohol. Just it was a big problem in his life. And I worked with him and shared with him and prayed with him. And one morning I came to church and I was just so frustrated because he wouldn't listen. And the pastor said, "Can I ask you some questions?" And I said, "Sure." And he said, "Do you think God's faithful?" I said, "Well, of course God's faithful. 1 Thessalonians 5:24 says, 'Faithful is the one who has called you, who also will do it.'" He said, "Okay. You think the Holy Spirit's faithful?" And I said, "Yeah, the Bible says he's sent out into the world to convict of sin, righteousness, and judgment. Yeah, he's faithful." He said, "Well, brother, if he ain't going to listen to the Holy Spirit, why would he listen to you?" Amen? That brings us right back to, we have to trust the Lord. We have to trust the Lord, and we want to trust the Lord. So in the midst of whatever challenges you and I are facing, it's my hope and prayer that we can truly look at our trials like Paul did. And if anybody was persecuted in the Bible, aside from Jesus, it was the Apostle Paul. He said, quote, 2 Corinthians 1:8 and 9, "This happened that we should not trust in ourselves, but we should trust in God who raises the dead." So I asked this morning, have you ever been to an art museum or ever seen beautiful art displayed on the TV? Have you ever noticed that all the masterpieces of painting contain a lot of shadows? Any masterpiece you look at has a lot of shadows in it to bring out the colors and the light. So we have to understand that a happy life is not filled only with sunshine. See, the world just says, don't worry, be happy. Well, we can't always be happy. Look at the life of Jesus. The Bible said Jesus wept. The Bible said when he went to Jerusalem and he looked over Jerusalem, he wept and said, how often would I have gathered you like a hen gathers her chicks, but you refused. I sent you prophets and you killed them. And he wept. And then when he went to visit the grave of his friend and he saw the distress of Mary and Martha, they had lost their brother, and they were somewhat angry at Jesus as well. They said, if you would have come, he wouldn't have died. And Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believes in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. And then he asked them this question, do you believe this? Do you believe that if you live and you believe in Christ, you'll never die? You'll give up your body for sure. Our body can't inherit the kingdom of God. But our soul and our spirit go to be with him. And then at some day when Christ comes to the clouds, he's going to raise us up in new bodies, in celestial bodies. He's going to raise us up in a brand new spiritual body, and we'll forever be with the Lord. We'll forever be with him. So a happy life isn't just filled with sunshine. It's also a life that uses both light and shadows to produce the beauty and the colors that we see. Suffering or persecution can become a blessing because it can form a backdrop for the light of Jesus Christ in our life. Amen. Don't despise the shadows that God has allowed to come into your life. They're there for a reason. To give the Lord an opportunity to bring glory and honor to his name and to bring blessing and fulfillment in your life. Amen. So with that, I'd like us to pray together, and then we're going to look into the Word of God to see if there's anyone else in this book that went through that stuff that Paul went through. Amen? Amen. All right. Heavenly Father, we love you, Lord. At times when we operate in our own self-sufficient mode, we rely on our own abilities and strengths, Father. Help us to remember that you are our strength. You are our shield. You are our comfort in all that we can face in this life. Father, when our trials and challenges begin to overwhelm us, help us to remember to call upon you first, because we need your power to endure. So I pray this morning, Father, as I share your word, that you will help us to trust you and to rely upon you and to put you first in everything. As you said in your word, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. So Father, this morning I pray for all of us, myself included. Lord, there are some of us who have family members that have wandered far from you, and some who've never come to you. And our prayer, Father, this morning is that they would come to you and that you would draw them with your love, and that our families would come together in the spirit of unity in Christ. And then I pray, Lord, for those marriages that are struggling. I pray, Father God, that you would put the healing balm of your word today on those as well. Father, that we would learn that it's not about me, it's not about us, it's about what you're doing in our lives. So, Father God, I pray blessing over this congregation as we prepare to look into your word. And I'll thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. So I want to share something very personal with you this morning about struggles. When I first got married, both of us were Christians. And I think that's a really good idea if you're planning on being married. We got into this discussion about Ephesians chapter 5 and Ephesians chapter 6. And it was my desire to read the Word of God and pray and get into the Word each and every night. And I think it's a good idea for families to do that, especially in these busy times. So we came across these scriptures that says, husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself for it. And then the other scripture said, wives, obey your husbands in the Lord, for this is right. And then you go on to chapter 6, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is the first commandment with promise, that you may live a long life and it may be well with you. And then he goes on to talk to servants, and he says, servants, obey your masters as unto Christ. And then he goes to masters, and he says, masters, don't provoke your servants, knowing that you have a master in heaven. So God talks a lot about submission, and I know that's a word that America loves, the word submission, you know. Yeah, especially if you're a biker. You love that word, you know. But here's the bottom line. We got into this discussion, and I knew it was getting heated fast. So, and the bad part of it was on our honeymoon. That's really hard. So I felt like the Holy Spirit said, you need to eject yourself out of this situation so I can talk to you. So I went and I got on my knees and I said, Lord, but it's what your word says. As if he didn't know. And he said, you're both wrong. I said, what? You're both wrong. I'm telling you, husbands, to love your wives as Christ loved the church. Does the church always obey the Lord? Does the church always follow the Lord? Does Jesus love the church anyway? And that's exactly the way the Lord put it to me. And the Lord said, you'll both stand before me about what you did with my commandments to you as a husband or a wife. But you are not to order one another around and say, well, you have to do this. I mean, like I've heard couples say, well, or wives say to their husbands, I wish you were more like Jesus. My answer would be, well, I wish you were more like Mary. You know, the fact of it is, these kind of struggles go on with almost every kind of relationship we have. And the fact of it is, we're all wrong. The Bible says, submit yourself to God, you know, and be ye holy. So God is concerned with us, and oftentimes what we want to do is push it off on somebody else. Well, I would have done that if they would have done this. Nope. The Lord says, I want you to do what I've asked you to do regardless of what anyone else does. Because of Romans chapter 5, verses 8 and 9. The Bible says, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Much more than being now justified by his blood, we will be saved from wrath through him. So while I was yet blaspheming God's name, while I was making fun of Christians, while I was throwing Bibles in the driveway, God loved me and he gave his son for me. And so that's the way we need to look, is up, not out. Amen? We need to look up. So there's some people in the Bible that I want us to take a look at. One of them is named Joseph. If you turn with me to Genesis chapter 50. Now, I don't want to go through the entire story of Joseph because it would take 2 hours and we've only got four left. So Genesis chapter 50, let me give you some backdrop. So Joseph is the younger brother and mom makes him a coat of many colors. She sews this beautiful coat. And she gives it to him, and all the brothers are like, well, what are we? Chopped liver? You know, and that's the New American Biker version, by the way. That's not really in Scripture. But they were jealous. They were envious. And the Bible says in Proverbs, who can stand before envy? So then Joseph has this dream, and he dreams that all of his brothers are bowing down to him, and he's the baby. And he's dreaming that all other 11 brothers are bowing down to him, and man, that ticks them off. So they all go out to the fields, and they decide, hey, let's just get rid of him. Let's just get rid of him. So what they do is they throw him in this big hole where he can't get out. And then they take a goat and they kill it and they put the blood all over his coat of many colors. And they take it back to his father and they tell father, he got killed by a wolf or whatever animal it was. And the father is grieving and they're all keeping this secret. Well, then these traders come along and they see Joseph in this hole and they pick him up and sell him as a slave into Egypt. And so he gets into Egypt and he's serving and he ends up in Potiphar's house. He ends up in the Pharaoh's house as a servant. And then Pharaoh's wife really gets enamored with him and wants to have relations with him. And he runs away and she grabs his coat and rips it off him. And then she falsely accuses him. He tried to have his way with me. So he gets thrown in prison. And then Pharaoh has this dream and Joseph interprets the dream and everything. It took a long time for all this to happen. And God restores Joseph and makes him number two in Egypt, the second in command. And Pharaoh finds out Joseph has a dream that there's going to be a famine. So he tells Pharaoh, we're having bumper crops. We need to save some of this stuff because there's a famine coming. And he gives him this word of prophecy, which is true. And so then all the way down the road in Israel, they're starving. And they said, hey, we heard in Egypt there's a lot of food there. We should go there and get food from Egypt. So they go there and guess who meets them? Their brother Joseph. God has made him second in command now. So that's the story, and we pick it up in verse 15 in Genesis chapter 50. Because during this time, Joseph's father died. And so when Joseph's brethren saw that their father was dead, verse 15, Genesis chapter 50, they said, Joseph will now hate us, and he will certainly pay us back for all the evil that we did to him. You know, that's the world's way. You know, you hit me, I'm going to hit you back. That's the world's way. But they thought, man, now that dad's dead, he's going to bring wrath down on us for what we did to him, the way we were envious of him, and we beat him and we threw him in this hole, and then he got thrown in prison and he got falsely accused and all this stuff. He is angry. Verse 16. So they sent a messenger to Joseph saying, your father commanded us before he died, saying that saying to Joseph, forgive, I pray now, the trespass of your brethren and their sin. For they did unto you evil. And now we pray you, forgive the trespass of the servants of the God of your father. And Joseph wept when they spoke those words to him. You know why God chose Joseph? He was pretty insignificant in the family. He was the baby. God chose him because he knew Joseph had a good heart. He had a soft heart. He had a heart to obey God. And so his brethren also went and fell down before his face. Did he not have that dream? Did he not dream that his brethren would fall down before him? And they did. They fell down before his face and they said, behold, now we're your servants. So it looks like everybody had a change of heart in this story. There's a lot of tough stuff went on in there. And Joseph said unto them, don't fear. Am I in the place of God? But as for you, you thought evil against me, but God meant it unto good, to bring to pass as it is this day, to save much people. I am promising you that things that we think are evil in our life, God turns it around for good. Can I give you a personal illustration? I will anyway. Okay. You've heard this story only 21 times. So my limit is 30 on each story. I was living a good life, man. Doing a workers' comp investigation for the state of California, did it for 22 years, made really good money, had really nice vacations, drove new cars every 3 years. I was living the high life. And all of a sudden, California, as and in their wisdom that they always have, chose to wreck the workers' compensation system by hiring somebody who charged way less money in Connecticut, a company from Connecticut, to come and do workers' comp in California. And it literally broke the system. 300 of us investigators lost our jobs. With that came the loss of the home that I owned, my income, just about really everything. And at one point, I didn't have any money at all. I wasn't old enough to get Social Security. And I'm still not old enough, but I get it anyway, Joe. So, but I wasn't old enough, so I had no money, and I had to leave my family. I had to leave my ministry. I had to go to Arizona, where it was 110 degrees in the summer, and take care of my stepmom just to earn money. She was going to hire a private nurse to take care of her, and my family said, wait a minute, when Greg got out of the Navy, didn't he take care of that elderly paralyzed man for 5 years? He knows how to do that. So that was my job, and it was a very difficult job, not just because it was hot, but because my stepmom was not the kindest person in the world, and so it was very, very difficult for me. And then I came back, and I was broke. I mean, B-R-O-K-E, no money. I had a friend tell me one time, man, I'm really worried. I've only got $5,000 in my savings account. And I said, what's a savings account? Man, I wish I had $5 in my checking account. So I prayed. And I said, Father God, what do I do now? I'm too old. They won't hire me anywhere. So what do I do? And the Lord said, I want you to go on the north end of town and start a Bible study. And it was like, okay, well, where would I do that? I mean, I don't have any money to rent a building. And I thought about that hotel over there off of the Broadway exit. I thought maybe they would, you know, allow me to have a meeting there and then pay them afterwards if we took an offering. And the Lord just told me to be still and start a Bible study. So it's a couple days later, I had a good friend of mine call me and say, hey, what have you been up to? And I said, well, I just got back into California. And he said, hey, why don't you, you know, I told him what was going on in my life. And he said, why don't you come to the prayer meeting here on Monday night? So I came here and prayed with him and with the pastor. And there were two or three people that used to come to the Bible or to the prayer meeting here. Now we have 20. Thank God. But typically there were two to three or sometimes four people. So I got to know the pastor, and I got bold enough one night to say, you know, Pastor, the Lord told me to start a Bible study on this end of town, and I don't have a building to have it in. Do you guys have Sunday night services here? And he said, no, we haven't for a long time. And I said, do you think you could maybe allow me to have a Bible study in your church on Sunday nights, and I'll help, you know, with whatever offerings come in, I'll help with the lights and everything. And he said, well, let me pray about it. It's never our timing. It's always God's timing. He prayed for 5 weeks. Every week I would come to the prayer meeting. Did God say anything to you? Still praying. Did God say anything to you? I'm still praying. It was like, wow, you must not be listening because God says, while you're yet speaking, I'll answer. It took 5 weeks. And on the fifth week, when I asked him again, he said, yes, matter of fact, why don't you come tomorrow night, on Tuesday night, we'll have an elders meeting, and you can meet with us, show us your notes, what do you want to teach, and we'll make a decision. So I came, and I had my notes on the book of Revelation, and I handed him the notes, and he looked at them, and he kept turning the pages, and he goes, well, this is just scripture. And I said, yeah, that's my notes. And he said, okay, you start this Sunday night. That's how I got here. And so I taught this Bible study starting 8 years ago, or maybe nine now. It was 2014, so that'd be eight. Yeah, 8 years ago. I started that Sunday night Bible study. And I had always blamed the devil for taking away my job. I had always said, Satan ripped me off. He put this thought in these California adjusters' minds to hire this company for, you know, $30 an hour cheaper, and they've ruined the whole system, and nobody's getting help now. And I just was blaming the devil. And one night I was standing up here teaching, and the Lord revealed to me, Satan didn't steal your job. I took it away. It was like, what? You took my good job away? And the Lord just, in my heart, showed me, I took your job away. Because you were getting way too comfortable with a big salary, new cars, fun times, big vacations, and I called you to preach my word. So I had to publicly apologize to the Lord and the people that were here. And say, I've been blaming the devil, and the Lord just showed me it was him all along. Because God knows the plans for our life. Amen. And they're good plans. They're not evil plans. To give us a future and an expected end. And I am so much happier now doing what God's called me to do. And you know, I had a great time doing investigations. It was a lot of fun, and there was a lot of adrenaline involved and all those things. But you know what? Until you're in the center of God's will for your life, you won't find true fulfillment. You just will not do it. And not everyone is called to preach from a little wooden pulpit like this. We're all called to different things. Some of us are called to pray. Some of us are called to help financially. Some of us are called to do other things. But just do what God has called you. And that will help us to be more like Christ. But I guarantee you, if the Apostle Paul says, brethren, I want you to know I haven't arrived, but this one thing I do, I forget those things which are behind. And I reach forth to those things which are before. And I press towards the mark of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. So we got to press through that stuff. Amen. And man, I'm telling you, I wasn't happy going through all that. That was a hard thing to go through. It killed my pride. It killed my bank account. It killed everything. But that's what the Lord had planned, so that he could put me and so he can put you where you need to be. And then he can bring forth those great miracles in our lives and show us he's always been in control. Amen. So then you look at David. Now, David, in the book of Psalms, Psalm 46, if you would. Psalm 46, David was the most persecuted guy in the Old Testament. I mean, Jeremiah got whacked a lot too, but David went to dinner one night and his father-in-law threw a spear at him, tried to kill him. And it's like, wow, David, I wouldn't eat there no more. So here's what he writes. David found out the secret of how God moves in our lives. Do you know that sometimes God will use things that look bad to bring us to him? So that he'll turn, like Joseph said, evil into good? So David writes, God is our refuge and our strength, a very present help in trouble. So, Pastor Joe, can I have you come up here a minute? Let me show you what that looks like. I'll pretend that I'm the Lord and he's my child, okay? Even though you're older than me, okay? So, okay, so I'm always with him, right here. I'm always at his right hand. What Paul was saying is, in trouble, I'm right here. A very present help. Amen. In trouble. Amen. God's always with us, but in trouble, very present help. Amen. In trouble. He's on top of us when we're in trouble. He says in verse 2, therefore we will not fear. Even if the earth is removed and the mountains are carried into the middle of the sea, even though the waters roar and are troubled, even if the mountains shake with a great swelling, because there's a river, the streams of which will make glad the city of God And guess who the city of God is? We are. The streams are the living water that Jesus talked about. The Word of God, His Spirit. That's the streams of God. He'll make glad the city of God, because doesn't the Bible say God does not dwell in temples made with hands? He dwells in us. Amen. We are His dwelling place. Amen. God is in the midst of her, and then He describes us as His bride. God is in the midst of her, she shall not be moved. God will help her, and that right early. Now the heathen raged, the kingdoms were moved, but God uttered His voice and the earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us. Do you believe that? Amen. That God is with you. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our hiding place, our refuge. Come and look and see the works of the Lord, what desolations He makes in the earth. He is the one to make wars to cease unto the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and cuts the spear in half and burns the chariot in the fire. So what does God want us to do? David learned this. Be still and know, God says, be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the heathen. I will be exalted in the earth. For the Lord of hosts is with us, and the God of Jacob is our refuge. Amen? Amen. David was greatly persecuted, but he learned the lesson to trust in God. There's a song, I've learned to trust in Jesus. I've learned to trust in God. Remember that one? I've learned to trust in Jesus. I've learned to trust in God. And God sometimes has to break us in order to get our self-sufficiency out of us, so that we can actually be of use to Him. Amen. And He knows how to do that. So then you come across Jeremiah. Now Jeremiah was a bold prophet. I mean, that guy walked in the room and people hated him. He was bold. And I want to show you what happened to Jeremiah and to show you that he's human, just like us. He's the same way we are. And you know, it's such a wrong way to think when people see a leader or a teacher or a pastor or whatever, and they put them up on a pedestal. That's wrong. That's so wrong. We are all the same. Amen. We are all the same. The only thing that's different about me when I get up here is God flows through me. But that can be in itself a challenge, because I not only get cut as the word goes out, I get cut when I hear it back. So I get cut twice. But I thank God that He can use us in such a way, each and every one of us. I remember when the ladies came to me and said, hey, you have a men's Bible study at your house. How come we don't have a women's Bible study? And I said, you want one? And they said, yeah, we want a women's Bible study. So I said, well, let me pray about it and see who the Lord would have. And I prayed and prayed, and the Lord kept putting Pam's face in front of my mind. And so finally, I just said, Lord, I think You choose Pam. And I really didn't know if Pam was a Bible teacher or anything else. And I went up to her and I said, Pamela, I've been praying about a Bible teacher for our women. And the Lord keeps putting Your face in front of me. Would you like to teach a women's Bible study? She turned white as a ghost and said, I've never taught anything ever to anybody. And I said, well, God said you are. And she said, well, I have to pray about that. And she prayed about it and came back, I don't know, it was a few days later, and she said, I really think you're right. I think I'm supposed to. And I don't know, Pamela, I think you start out with 4 or 5, whatever it was.
I pray, dear God, if I have 4, that will be good. We had 8.
Oh, wow, you had 8 the first time. And now you have in the 20s. Yeah. So hallelujah. Praise God. Never did that before, did you? Hey, I got news for you. I never went to Bible school. I barely graduated high school. Joined the U.S. Navy, got out of the Navy, and joined an outlaw motorcycle club. I have had no Bible training, zero, except from the Holy Spirit. He's the best teacher. Don't sell yourself short. Don't say, well, I just don't know how to do that. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Amen. Just let God use you in whatever way God wants to use you. Everybody has a different thing to do. It's okay. There's not one more important than another. It's just obey the Lord in what God wants you to do. And when the whole body works together, then we can actually be a body and walk around and move and have hands and feet and eyes and ears. It works really well that way. So here's poor Jeremiah, and God tells me, why don't you go and rebuke these people? He says, Lord, they've already tried to kill me a few times. I really don't think I'm welcome there. He says, no, you need to go. So here's his welcoming committee, Jeremiah chapter 38, verse 1. Then, and forgive me if I mispronounce these, then Shephatiah, the son of Matan, and Gedaliah, the son of Pashur, and Jukal, the son of Shelemiah, and Pashur, the son of Malchiah, heard the words that Jeremiah had spoken unto all the people, which he said, thus saith the Lord, he who remains in this city will die by the sword. Oh, well, that's a positive, uplifting message right there. You know, just go to the city hall. If you stay here, you're going to die. Yeah, they're going to love you for that. And that's what Jeremiah said. If you stay in this city, you're going to die by the sword. And then he says, and by famine, and by pestilence. But he that goes forth to the Chaldeans will live, for he will have his life for a prey, he will live. Thus saith the Lord, this city will surely be given into the hand of the king of Babylon's army, who will take it. Therefore the princes said to the king, those guys up there that I just named were princes, they said, we beseech you, let this man be put to death. In the New American Biker version, it said, can we go snuff this guy? Okay, and here's what the king said. For they said, he's weakening the hands of the men of war, our army soldiers that remain in this city, and the hands of all the people speaking such words like this. This man doesn't seek the goodness or the welfare of this people. He wants to hurt them. Wow. Then Zedekiah the king said, behold, he's in your hands. For the king is not he that can do anything against you. So what did they do? They took Jeremiah, they threw him into a dungeon of Malchiah, the son of Hamelech, that was in the court of the prison, and they let him down with cords. Now this is a hole in the ground. This is not, you know, oh gosh, there's a library, I can become an attorney. Oh, here's weights I can push. That's none of that. This is a hole in the ground, and they're lowering him down with ropes. He's not getting out of there. And in the dungeon, there was no water, but only mire. And Jeremiah sank deep into the mire. Wow. We think we got it bad. Can you imagine being Jeremiah? God said, I want you to go do this, son. He said, Lord, they hate me. They've already tried to kill me. He said, you need to go and tell them. Tell them the truth. Go ahead. Go on now. He goes and tells them, and then they go to the king and say, hey, we want to snuff this guy. And the king says, it's not in my hand to do any different. Do what you want. And so they put him in this big hole in mire, in refuge, in garbage. And he sunk down into it. So now I want you to turn to Lamentations, which is right next door to the right-hand side. So the book of Lamentations is a book of tears that Jeremiah wrote. It was a book of complaints or tears. This is what happened to me. And he's the only prophet in the Bible that God let do that. He wrote a book of tears. And so here we are in chapter 3, and Jeremiah's talking to the Lord. Okay, so somehow he got out of that hole, but there's also other 30 other or 20 other chapters in the book of Jeremiah that he went through the same kind of stuff. So he got hammered everywhere he went. And so by chapter 3 of his book, here's what he says to the Lord. I am a man that has seen affliction by the rod of God's wrath. He has led me and brought me into darkness, not into the light. Do you think he's upset? That's a pretty heavy accusation to give to the Lord. You better know him really good if you're going to talk to him like that. And Jeremiah did. And he goes, and it gets way worse. In verse 3, he said, surely God is against me. He's turned his hand against me all the day. My flesh and my skin he has made old, and he has broken my bones. He has builded against me and surrounded me with gall and travail. He has set me in dark places like those who have been dead for a long time. He has hedged me about and I can't get out. And he's made my chain heavy. I guarantee you God did not do that. There are times that we get so blinded to our trials that we blame God. And we have to remember who God is. Sometimes God will allow things, but it's the devil that steals, kills, and destroys. It is not God. And I've talked to people who said, God killed my mother and I hate him and I'm never going to church and on and on and on. And I say, God doesn't kill anybody except the wicked at the judgment. God is the God of the living, not the God of the dead. It is Satan who comes to steal, kill, and destroy. And man, I don't understand a lot of things that happened. My mom passed away when I was 27 and my dad when I was 30. Oh, I don't understand that, but I do understand this. God has given me so many wonderful spiritual fathers and spiritual mothers in the time that I've known him. It is amazing. And you know, he says that in the scripture. He who has forsaken mother and father, sister and brother, lands and houses for my sake in the gospel, shall in this life inherit 100-fold mothers and fathers and sisters and brothers and houses and lands, and in the life to come, eternal life. So God always replaces things in our lives if we'll be patient and wait to see how he's going to work. Jeremiah's ticked off. Verse 7. He says, I can't even get out. He made my chain heavy. Verse 8, when I cry and shout, he shuts my prayer out. Is that true? God says, call unto me, I will answer you. I will show you great and mighty things. Do you know that that scripture is in Jeremiah's book in Jeremiah 33:3? He wrote that himself. He has enclosed my ways with hewn stone. He has made my path crooked. My Bible tells me that he makes my path straight. But Jeremiah said, you made my path crooked. He was like to me like a bear lying in wait, like a lion in secret places. He has turned my ways aside and pulled me into pieces and made me desolate. Wow. He has bent his bow and set me as mark for his arrow. He envisioned God as putting a bullseye around him and going like this. He has caused the arrows of his quiver to enter into my heart. I was a derision to all of my people and I was their song all the day. In other words, people sang songs about me. Awful songs. He has filled me with bitterness. He has made me drunk with wormwood. He has also broken my teeth with gravel stones. He has covered me with ashes. And God, now he gets personal, and thou hast removed my soul far off from peace so that I forgot about prosperity. Wow. And then I said, Jeremiah's back to speaking, my strength and my hope has perished from the Lord. No hope in God. We got a lot of people in our country like that right now. There's no hope. Oh, there's lots of hope. Yeah, he that sits in the heavens will laugh at them. The Lord will have them in derision. God is in full control. But I think what God's been doing for the last couple of years is, America, you've kind of just gone along and been kind of blind. So I'm really going to show you how evil this system really is. Some people say, are you talking bad about our country? No, I'm not. I'm just telling the truth, and I'm a good observer. I've investigated those things. Lie after lie after lie after lie after cover up after cover up. And now we got FBI agents and others coming out to tell the truth about what's really happened. That doesn't move me. I love America. I served in the U.S. military for our country. I love our country. I fly our flag. We got a flag on the back wall back there. We got flags over here. I love our country. I just despise the liars who try to ruin it. Amen. And so does God. Psalm 7:11 says God is angry with the wicked every day. Every day. Just like Jeremiah was angry. So Jeremiah says, "So remembering my affliction and my misery and the wormwood and the gall, my soul still has them in remembrance and is humbled in me." All of a sudden, the Holy Spirit comes upon Jeremiah and opens his eyes. Kind of like my eyes got open when I used to blame the devil for taking away my job, and all of a sudden, bing, that wasn't the devil. That was me, said the Lord to my heart. I wanted you to be where I needed you, not where you wanted to be. God's a much better guide than we are. He has a better architectural plan for our life than we do. Amen. And so he says, I'm recalling this to my mind, and therefore, or all of a sudden, I have hope. Bing, light comes on to Jeremiah. What about that, Jeremiah? He said, well, it's because of the Lord's mercies that I'm not consumed, because God's compassions don't fail. They are new every morning. Great is his faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him. And the Lord is good unto those who wait for him, to the soul who seeks him. So then Jeremiah changes his whole heart. And he says, it is good that a man or a woman would both hope and quietly wait for the salvation of the Lord. There's that word that we love, right, church? Wait. Yeah. So like Joseph, like David, like Jeremiah, we know that all things will work together for good to those who love the Lord, to those who are the called according to his purpose. All things. Good things, bad things. Happy things, sad things. Hard things, easy things. Blessed things, cursed things. All things work together for good to those who love the Lord. So let's close our service with those scriptures. Amen. Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8, starting with verse 28. The Bible doesn't say we guess, or we hope, or we're kind of sure. The Bible says we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to those who are the called according to his purpose. And let me just take you on a quick trip to the Red Sea. Here's 3 million Jews at the Red Sea, and they're in a box canyon. And here's Pharaoh's army coming after them. And those guys were ready for war. They were in chariots. They had spears. They had bows and arrows. They swords. They were going to kill the Israelites. That was their intent. They're standing there, and what do? They blame Moses. You brought us out here so that Pharaoh would kill us. And they start blaming Moses. And all of a sudden, this fog bank appears. Oof, where nobody can see that way, and the people that are that way can't see this way. So they had to stop. And God speaks to Moses, and he says, I'm going to part this sea here, this Red Sea, and I'm going to have you go over on dry ground. And Moses is looking at the Lord like, okay, so what do you want me to do? Well, I want you to take that stick in your hand and point it over the water. Now, the Israelites are already upset. They're already blaming Moses, and they already think they're going to die. But God, in the night, caused a wind to blow, and in the morning, which is really an impossibility, but nothing is impossible with God. Amen. The sea is standing up on two edges, and the land is dry, and they walk across the land. Now, I had a professor tell me one time, he said, you know what, that's actually a fairy tale. He said, if you do some study about the Red Sea, you'll find that at that time of year when they crossed, the Red Sea is very, very low in one certain place. It's about 18 inches, and they just walked across. And I said, well, praise God, that's a bigger miracle. He drowned all of Pharaoh's army and their horses in 18 inches of water. Idiot. So, yeah, that was me. That wasn't the Lord. Okay. Romans chapter 8, verse 28. We know that all things work together for good to those who love God. Do you love God, church?
Amen.
God says all things are going to work together for good. It may look bad now, but all things are going to work together for good. That's God's word. To those who were the called according to his purpose. For whom God did foreknow, he knew us before we were born. I think it was Dan that talked about Psalm 139, it was Pastor Loida that talked about Psalm 139 this morning. He knows our uprising, he knows our downsetting, he formed us in the womb. We're fearfully and wonderfully made. Yeah, God knew us before we were born, before we were in our mother's womb. So for those he did foreknow, he predestinated to be conformed to the image of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, those he predestinated, those he also called. And whom he called, he also justified. And whom he justified, them he also glorified. At some point, he's coming to the clouds and we're going to be glorified.
Amen.
Praise God. So there's a question here in Romans 8 as we end this service. What shall we say then to these things? What are we going to say about all the stuff we just read? If God be for us, who can be against us? He that didn't spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how will he not with him freely give us all things? Who will lay anything at the charge of God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is the one who condemns? It's Christ who died, rather that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who makes intercession for us. Did you know, Anthony, that while Daniel was in the hospital, Jesus was praying for him? Isn't that amazing? That when we've had issues, that Jesus himself is praying for us to the Father. Wow. So who's going to separate us from the love of Christ? Will trouble, tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or even sword? As it is written, for your sake we're killed all the day long and accounted as sheep for the slaughter. But no, Paul writes, in all these things we are more than conquerors. Through him that loved us.
Amen.
These last two verses are so important. Paul said, I'm persuaded. Now, there's some things that I'm persuaded about and I'm not willing to change. I'm persuaded that the death, burial, and resurrection is my payment from Jesus Christ to get into heaven along with his shed blood. I'm persuaded I'm not going to change.
Amen.
I'm persuaded. There's other things that I might listen to and say, you know, I never saw it that way. Yeah, I accept that. But there's some things that I'm persuaded about and some things that you're persuaded about, you're not going to move.
Amen.
And thank God you won't.
Amen.
We live in a world that's like a noodle, you know, they change every 10 minutes. No, we got to be firm on some things that we know are the truth.
Amen.
We know there's an afterlife.
Yes.
We know that there's a God in heaven and a devil in hell.
That's right.
We know that we have the victory through Jesus Christ our Lord. And we know that he's coming to the clouds to take us home someday and that he promises us an abundant life here. We don't have to wait till then. We can have it now here.
Amen.
And so he says, I'm persuaded that neither death nor life, nothing in dying and nothing in living, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor anything present, nor anything in the future to come. Nothing high or low in depth. No other creature will be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Isn't that good news?
Amen.
Praise God. Would you stand with me, church? What am I trying to say? I'm not trying to say much, but I'll tell you what God's saying. Trust Him.
Amen.
Don't try to do it yourself. Just allow Him to work in your life. The Lord has a perfect timing for everything. Sometimes we want to force things. Let's not force anything. Blessed are those who wait upon the Lord, for He will renew their strength. They will mount up with wings as eagles. They will run and not be weary, and they will walk and not faint. Father, we want to thank You for the time that we've been able to spend here with You. And it's been with You, Lord. It's Your word. It's Your truth. It's Your spirit. And You've moved on our hearts this morning. Lord, we're not uninformed. So many people are going through trials and tribulations, and some are being pressed like they've never been pressed before in their entire life. And Father, I pray that Your word today has caused us to understand now's the time to jump into Your lap and let You be our shield and our fortress and our hiding place and our high tower. For You alone are worthy, Lord. You're in control of our life. You said You hold the breath of every man in Your hand. And I thank You this morning for so many. Father, as I was talking to Terry, Dana's wife, and she shared with me how the doctor said she had no hope, and yet You healed her of cancer. And how the doctors had a bad news for Daniel. But here he is this morning, Father, happy and walking and being blessed to be in Your house. And so many others that we can't even bring all the names together, it would take all day, that have been blessed beyond measure. Pain taken away, arms healed, legs healed, cancers healed. So many things, Father. So we look to You today. And we thank You. And we give You praise and glory for all that You're doing in our midst. And Lord, because we have believed that You loved us so much that You sent Your only begotten Son into the world to die for us and pay for our sins and shed His blood that we could be washed clean. Because we've done that, we've called upon Your name. Father, we extend that invitation to anyone within the sound of our voice, including those on YouTube, that if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and your Savior, you can ask Him to come into your life. You can do it this very moment. You can simply, with your heart, believe that He is God, sent from heaven to die for you. You can ask Him to come into your life. He says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hears My voice and opens the door, I will come into him." So, Lord, for anyone hearing Your voice right now, my prayer is that they will open the door of their heart and invite You to come in. Turn from your own ways, from your sin, from your failings, and turn to Jesus. Ask Him to forgive you and invite Him to come in. And He will. For He said, "Everyone that asks receives, and the one who knocks, it shall be opened. And the one who seeks, it shall be found." So, Father, I pray that that is the heart of what You wish for every single person in the sound of My voice. And I pray today, Lord, there may be some here who really desire prayer.
who really believe, who really want a healing, whether it's emotional, spiritual, financial, whatever it might be. Lord, we invite them to come forward, to come and pray. We'll join them in prayer and pray with them, Lord. So thank you for the message today. Help us to not despise the shadows that are in our life, because those shadows bring out the glory of your light and the beautiful colors that you want to paint on our canvas. Father, I pray now that you will dismiss us with your blessing. I thank you for your presence here today, as always. We will never take that for granted, Father. Thank you for being here with us today. In Jesus' holy name. Amen and amen. God bless you, church. You're dismissed this morning. Take some time to greet one another as well. And if you do need prayer, please come forward. We'll be happy to pray for you.
Punishment that was due for our peace was laid on.